Hello to you all. My name is Alexey Filimonov. I am the director for working with participants of Skolko Technopark. I am the moderator of a very interesting session, namely how to start high-tech business in Russia. I have very nice composition of participants. We are not going to give any presentations. I am going to give floor to each of the speakers. They will talk about their way of starting a high-tech business in Russia, or how he helps others to do so. And we will have a discussion on every interesting subject. Off we go. Okay, look, we live at a very interesting point of time. The colleagues that got together, all of them started high-tech business long time ago, or not long time ago. Some passed to venture investment, some will pass to Atasem. First, I'd like to give the floor to you, Arman Gokasan. I know your success story. You're a person who could start business anywhere in Russia or in any other country. You have truly international background, but you came to Russia without being an IT specialist, and you got integrated. What spurred you to do so? Shall I first share information about my company? First, say a few words about your company. Well, talking about my company, I think you'd rather have a look. I have 1 minute video, and it's better to take a look rather than to talk about it. Is this about you? Yeah, music is mine, but okay, here is the video. We started in 2008, and remember when I set up a company by answering your question why I started this business. What we do, just in a few words, we deal with applied game technologies. We develop cloud solutions for engineers, for architects, that is sold successfully throughout around the globe. And in 2008, I entered the Russian market and established my company and attracted British investments. There was not a startup fashion or fag in Russia. All were investing in properties, were selling, buying. That happened prior to the economic crisis, exactly right. And we started in January 2008, and then the crisis took place. And as for my background, it is indeed truly international. I studied and worked in Switzerland. I also got my MBA in France. I also worked in the US, and I started working in Russia in 2005 when I started working in a mapping Swiss company. And that's why it all started. But in 2008, we were able to transfer all these games, interactive games, into a serious industry, and that's how it all started. But you chose Russia. Why? That was just a coincidence. The climate was not attractive. No, of course. I just happened to be here. I met the people that established the company together with me. I knew the some tech specialists. And as we set up our company, my dream was to show that a Russian company can become truly global. And today, we're still proving that by demonstrating what we do. Of course, there are lots of problems in terms of red tape, the legal constraints. However, we continue working, operating. Okay, we'll get back to red tape. Okay, Michael, you started much earlier. I remember your company in Taco, yes, in 1992. I wanted to buy your translator tool. You did not regard it as a classic startup as in Silicon Valley, but nevertheless, that's what it was. You established a company that now has gained a foothold in the global market, right? Yeah, but the company was set up very easily. If you remember, the famous episode from Yerolash, we were learning how to play football based on the Brazilian experience. We had to strike iron while hot, and so there was an idea. And in 5 or 6, that was once again 1992, and 5 years later, we were the leaders on the market. And basically, there was no market. We actually created the market in this area, but the company was set up in the U.S. It was developing in the U.S. I dedicated 9 years to this company, and as I dropped out of it, it was 2001, I was looking for another company, so I returned to Russia. Well, basically, I never abandoned it. I would go back and forth because I continued some business here, as well as throughout the world, but then I would come to Russia more often, and a year later, I had a very fashionable at that time outsourcing business. So the reason why I chose Russia was simple and very practical. I paid on average $5 or $6 per hour to each of my employees, and then I would sell each employee for $35 per hour. However, in at the end of 2003, the margin has decreased by 3 times because many operational costs increased, and I could not sell my employees for higher costs. But $35 was a good rate, and it was profitable for me. And I understand that I already had a good technical basis, and because after all, in Russia we have good high-skilled engineers who still cost cheaper than in the United States. So this is the advantage of the market, and you should use it. And in 2003, I launched yet another project that was a food product company that was sold successfully 4 years later by launching it in 2003. In 2005, we were the largest software manufacturer for BlackBerry, and BlackBerry controlled almost 90% of the market of cell phone market that was the predecessor of smartphones. So that's how I set up a company and would sell it. Okay, very good. But now you support companies at a very early stage. This experience of yours, does it help you, or you would rather these young guys not to encounter the problems that you faced at some point? No, on the contrary, I would like them to encounter the same issues that I did some time ago. Often when we hold preliminary meetings, I offer, and talking to future startup, when I hear his model, and I often ask him, okay, yeah, tell me, chap, have you ever been able to sell anything to anyone? And typically the answer is, I think I'll be able to do it. I think it's very critical for the business to sell services or products. If you cannot sell goods or services, you are not capable of anything. So I think that's my understanding back from 1992. You either are able to sell what you can do or what you have conceived, or you cannot do it. So this is we've been developing a startup accelerator for 2 years. We have invested 16 projects. 12 of them are still alive and are developing robustly. And I look at my partners and I understand that only those who understand what the product is about and who can sell it are still can continue business. Do you think it's easier to start high-tech business, or due to globalization, to making boundaries open, it's more complex? No, on the contrary, it's much easier, it's much cheaper, actually, to turn idea into a prototype and prototype into a product or alpha product. It actually costs up to 50,000 product, and that's relevant for any type of idea. You're talking about software project, of course, only about software project, not about hardware project.
Ivan, I would like to give floor to you. Please tell us about your achievements. I know that you have run through the full cycle in terms of venture investments, and you even made IPO, which is quite a rare thing in Russia. But you already have experience that you may boast, I think. Although I heard that if you were starting it again from the scratch, probably you would not go for IPO. Okay. First, few words about myself. Why high technology business? I've been working in this business for 15 years already. When we started our investments with Vladimir Angelsky, we were doing angel investments, and we were working with the complicated software which we were selling to starting from enterprises and even to private companies. Then we started working on a big project. It was actually related to remote reading of data, and I worked as a developer, project manager, commercial director, executive director, and finally managing director. So I worked in all the positions of the company I was creating. And right now we are in terms of installed media, we are fifth or sixth in the world. Well, everyone heard about implementing GLONASS system. We work not only in Russia, but also in 22 other countries of the world. First, we found angel investments. I suggested the idea, and this person believed in what I was going to implement. The market was new, and the surveillance systems were very new. And we spent 4 years to somehow form this market. Found competitors, and then there were two rounds of venture investments, IPO, international expansion, and so on and so forth. I think that telemetrics market is actually a very good example of where you may find high technology products, and a very good example of how, for example, one person should sell, should be able to sell the product, and it's very important. Well, I think for a person working on the international market, it is very important to have a vision, because there were many, many ways that might be taken on this new market. But if you believe it's something specific, if you see where a market is going on, it is actually the key thing. Because it is not of crucial importance to have the resources. It's very important to have a vision, to be able to find clients. And I think I was lucky in this life to be able to learn these things, to understand how I should work, and my all experience with my company. Thank you. Pavel, Please introduce yourself. You represent a company not from the opposite side, but just, the state looked for opportunities. And I know that over the years, you've given thousands of grants to young companies, to startups. From your point of view, is it easy to start business? It's first thing. And secondly, does the state act in a correct way? Does it support in a due way? Please explain us on the role of your development institute and the state in general. And also, you have a video. Yes, I would like to start with the video. Please launch it. It is called Development Fund. I do represent the Fund of Development, which is well known as Bortnik Fund. Mr. Bortnik was actually moderating one of the main sessions today on the main stage. How is it with the video? It all starts with small things. And the fund actually reached big achievements in seed and pre-seed financing. Pre-seed is actually UMNIC program, which means smart. We support smart young scientists in the age of up to 20 years, and they may get financing up to 400,000 rubles for 2 years. Even creating a legal entity is not mandatory. And in this way, we finance up to 500 startups in all the directions of innovative scientific sector. They may reach up to 1 million and up to 2 million on the next stage, on the conditions that it attracts 2 more million from the side of private investor. And for yet another stage, it's 3 plus 3 million. There are various support programs, such as development and cooperation programs to cooperate with the companies of France, Finland. It's just in general about the fund. Then, as to if it's easy to start a business, I think that over the last years, it has become easier in Russia to start business. At least all the elements of innovative structure that we may find in other countries, they are all present in Russia. We support fundamental researchers. We have the Russian Fund of Fundamental Research and Development. We have development of seed and pre-seed financing. This is what we do and what Russian venture company seed fund does. We have opportunities to attract loans with discounts from a subsidiary of Vneshekonom Bank. So we can't say that some elements that are present in other countries are absent in Russia. It is not so. Probably what we still need is financing from the part of business angels, but they are also present in Russia. Konstantin Fokin was recently speaking from this stage. From the point of view whether it's easy or not, I think it's easier than it was before, but comparing to other countries, I think business angel financing and pre-seed financing is still needs to be enhanced in Russia. If it increases twofold, threefold, then it will boost startups. And for example, all the financing provided by Rosnano was all those projects were supported by us as well, and we still feel that financing is lacking. Over 100 startups were run through our fund, but it's still not enough. What do you think? The problem is in the financing, which is not enough, but or in the projects, in the number of projects that are not enough. Actually, it's difficult to judge what comes first. I think 10 years ago, the initial problem was in financing. And I may say that each year we support 500 startups, and we support all the high-class projects that we see. And I can say at once that if you have a high-class project, high-level project, you are going to get the support. And we need to increase the financing, and it will result in more and more high-level projects. And what is the share of regional projects that get the support in Moscow? So what is the Moscow share and the regional share as to projects? According to START project, more than over 80% come from Russian Federation substitutes. Maybe the matter is that in Moscow, half a million is not regarded as a big sum of money. But we are actually not pretending on being the only source of financing. We are only for the projects getting financing from private investors. I once was introducing our system in one of the conferences, and I was asked by the Moscow entrepreneurs that please increase your sum of financing, and then we will come to you. And I said, no, I'd better stay with the sum we have to attract more of regional projects. Svetlana, now the floor is yours. Please, you may add what you have to add. Just as Arman, I am working with IT business for fifth or sixth year. I started with an American company. Oh, sorry, announcement. Hopefully, we will not lose too many people. So, I had a very clear vision, and I thought that IT business in Russia, it's what we need, and it's what we'll be boosting on. So I joined TechnoServe group of companies, and after some time, I realized clearly that development of integrator business is great, but probably I can do something else for the industry in general. And at that time, I joined the domestic software developers. We strongly support big developer companies, Abi, 1C, and other companies, as well as many startups. Part of Skolko projects are part of our associations. I also joined the Association of Innovative Regions. We work closely with the programs offered by regional authorities together with Bortnik Fund. Our colleagues often say that, okay, from our regions, five projects won the financing program. From our regions, we are going to subsidize them as well. And these programs are on in Kaluga, in Bashkortostan, in Krasnoyarsk, Tatarstan. This is what about startups. As to middle-sized business, in last year, we saw a very interesting project launch in Tech Uspech, technical success, it means. And I hope the results will be only improving over a year. We run this project to see if there is high technology business in Russia. We feared that we will not get even 100 projects, but we had more. And what we saw were the companies working with high technologies that we never heard of from faraway regions that were well known in their regions but were not known to us. So one of our aims is to look at financial opportunities as well as technology component. Ruslan, I give the floor to you. You have a very interesting sector that you are working at, Russian Quantum Center. I can't even call it business. So please tell us a few words on how do you operate. Is it going to become business? Well, it is true that I represent Russian Quantum Center. At the first glance, we are not business. We are not startup. And I would like to say again a few words. Ruslan probably received one of the biggest grants. Not me personally, the Russian Quantum Center. Yes, it is true. Our purpose is to create a scientific center in terms of quantum technologies, and we know that scientific technologies can't be held over 1 year. It's a long-term project, so our grant has been given for 5 years. It's one of the unique cases. So are we a business? Our term is not profit. But speaking about startups, a good startup is the development of an idea that may be sold. Where do ideas come from? We plan that our center is going to be one of the sources of ideas that will be the initiation for startups. And it is our purpose, actually, to give birth to startups. One of the most ambitious tasks for Russian Quantum Center is to develop the Russian quantum computer. No one knows when it's going to come, in 10 years or 20, but it is evident that working on this task, we come across many challenges. The scientists come across many challenges that make them develop new devices, new ways of working, and very often they are consumed by today's industry. Right now, we have four scientific groups, and one of the head of these groups works with two startups in terms of one photon detectors and the other in another topic. And this is actually what we want. We want to be interesting for the industry. We need to attract long-term investments. Another direction that we are working on is providing researchers for big companies such as Yandex or Sberbank or another company which is interested in the technologies of future, such as absolutely secure communication channel, cryptography, or banking computing. So in general, that's what the idea is. Okay, thank you. So I've listened to all of you. You have different experiences. Some started their businesses in Russia or in the US, and sometimes people with startups come and ask, "What should I go to the Silicon Valley and start my business there?" So, do you have an answer to that, Mikhail? Please share your opinion with us. You work here. Well, you shouldn't go to the valley if you don't have specific purposes there. Actually, the Russian IT market is very extensive. You have a big space to develop within. You have enough resources to test and work with your project. And if people pose their question as if we should go to the valley, well, you may, but it will be more expensive. There is no sweet spot in the valley, apart from the cases when you have U.S. companies specifically among your clients. It all depends on your share of market, on your clients, and, of course, your product, the thing they are going to sell. The valley is not a purpose in itself, it's just a place. Other opinions? Actually, I agree. However, the world is global. It doesn't matter where actually you work. You may get positive atmosphere, best practices in the Silicon Valley, but it doesn't matter where you work. It's what matters is the purpose of your company, the mood and the it is what lacks in our country actually, because we keep on blaming ourselves and saying that, okay, we are good for nothing. It's what we need is to change our approach. So what you are speaking right now, it's acceptance of failure. No, it's not about acceptance of failure. It's actually more than that.
We need to understand that our country has not only short-term prospects, but long-term prospects as well. And, you know, many youngsters are striving to leave this country, study abroad, and stay there. And this is scary because people think in the short term, because we often see short-term policy from our leaders and when it comes to innovative business. However, many things are changing, and I should say that 5 years ago we had an entirely different situation, so do not listen to what's been broadcasted by NTV channels and others, and just continue doing in what you believe and continue developing. Okay, Ivan, you said that you worked for 12 years in telemetry. Yeah, so your company has been in place for 7 years. Okay, I just need to remember that you need to add one more year each year. Yes, we've been here on the market for 7 years. Did you experience hard times when you felt pessimistic? I believe that each and any of us went through hard times, for us through rainy days. That's actually very natural. That's part of human nature. I don't really think that this is natural for everyone, but what would you do in that instance? How would you get back and continue fighting? Let me get back and asking about investing in Russia or Silicon Valley. Basically, I should tell you that there are many companies that already invest in Europe. I think that today it is much easier to get money in Russia rather than in Europe or in the US, especially when it comes to signing contracts. The conditions, terms and conditions offered by American or European investors cannot be compared by the amount of investments that you will get from venture or state institutions. The other thing is the difference in mentality. If you are not planning to live in a different, in a foreign country, and if you just want to launch your money there, you need to spend 3 or 4 years in order to bring your idea across. So there are lots of cultural differences, and therefore when you get some finances, well, I would actually be more focused on the on Russia. And as for my attitude, when okay, it's all done, whatever does not kill us make us stronger. So I would rephrase and say that any positive, negative event in your life is experience. So basically, life is about getting experience. The more experience you gain, the more interesting your life is. And experience is not always about success, it's about failures as well. So for me, it was the most stimulating factor to move forward. And of course, faith in my ideas that I promote, and I sincerely believe, and I've been reiterating it over and over again, that, and I'm saying that very soon, all, yes, the changes of all the changes will take place. Okay, I'm having this process here. This is a process. This is a bracelet to monitor, for your wife to monitor you. No, no, this is not it. Okay. Basically, you know, you can remove this thing off your hand. Actually, that monitors your day, work, and sleep mode. Getting back to the core subject of our discussion. So you believe that Russian money are cheaper, therefore you need to get them here. And once they're not cheaper, this is not the right way to say, but just speaking on average, here it is much easier for an entrepreneur to get money. But it's not always a matter of getting money. It's not the end objective. By the way, that's a very good comment. You might get a million here, however, it won't be valuable. However, you can get 500,000 in the US, but you also will gain a strategic partner who can help you develop to a certain level of development, because for start-uppers, especially for those who are not a serial entrepreneurs but just truly start-uppers, many of them are not aware of managing their business, of peculiarities of foreign markets, so it's not an issue of money, getting money, it's an issue of getting smart money. So I would say that it doesn't matter where you are, it's a matter of getting access to smart money. By the way, this is a very interesting question. We are talking about money over and over again, but I think that after all, money is the most attractive thing in high-tech business. I don't really think so. What is it in your opinion? For you, as for you, what motivates you? The idea, I don't care about money as the final end. Okay, Alexander has said it all. So those who are interested in money and prizes move to the central stage. So it's not a money of issue of money. It's an issue of what you do, what you are interested in, about your face in your activities. And I might sound pathetic, however, that might change the market for the better or a certain segment of the market. And that's the most important thing, because only face can bring startups or entrepreneurs to a positive result, because in the course of your activities, you go through so many hurdles, and that means that if you don't believe in your company, you just will die. That's far more important. So values are far more important, values that you believe in. And I heard the same thing from Ivan. Mikhail, do you agree? Yes, there is a famous model, people's processes, values. Each company is a mini model of its founder. These are the values. So by setting up your company, you put your soul into your business, and basically you put your values into it as well. And at the end, this is not the end in itself. And then as you move from business to business, you pass along the values from company to company. You can change people, however, you cannot change values. They always exist, they're passed by the founder, and this is the invaluable contribution of the founder. Therefore, it is so pleasing and so inspiring to work. Money comes second. Basically, this is a measure of success. However, you take pleasure from business, and not only from the fact that your business is commercially successful, but also that it exists, especially when the company has grown and you moved to new horizons. And once you when you visit the company that you have set up, you set up a long time ago, you see that it continues operating and people might have changed, the employees are different, however, values are the same, and it's really very inspiring. Pavel, at FASI, do you see the face of people who join you, people who actually join you for money? Do you see faith in you, faith in your product, faith in their ability to have an impact on this world and change it for the better? I think that the key thing in the selection of employees, I would not speak for the entire expert community, because we want to make sure that support will be extended to the regions. However, what is needed, of course, not only money, but the resource of each high-tech business are people or human resources. And if you want to join Silicon Valley, that's a challenge, and you need to be mature enough to go there. So talking about the start of your business, of course, you need to start it in the environment that you understand well, where you have classmates, where you're able to make up a group of peers, of kindred souls, who will help you implement your ideas. Here at Skolkovo, we first provided support to small and medium-sized businesses, then we supported startups, and when we realized that you need to provide human resource support, that's when we launched the program called Smart People. And basically, we understand that 20% of our smart guys start their business, but it's better to provide an opportunity to the student to launch his own project and understand whether this is his calling or not. And with this, we provide opportunities to hundreds of youngsters to launch their business rather than to be hired as a manager at some nice and cozy place. This is the answer regarding faith. And perhaps this is a question to Svetlana. I know that you work a lot with colleges. In your opinion, do colleges as an environment solve an issue of training gifted entrepreneurs for high-tech companies? I think if you ask any on the stage whether they get many managers from institutions or from educational facilities, unfortunately, it's obvious that you do not get any employees from college graduates. You know what? In terms of getting knowledge, of course, our educational facilities are very outdated in terms of syllabus, and we understand that getting back to the regions, and that's getting back to your previous question, when a startup is set up in Tomsk or Novosibirsk, many young people say that, you know, for us it doesn't make a difference whether to come to Moscow or to Silicon Valley. We'd rather go to Silicon Valley. Here in Moscow we have Rosnano, Skolkovo here. However, there still it works much easier. But of course, many startups are set up and developed here, and there are many colleges and universities that support them. It depends on the provost, and Tomsk Polytech is a good example. So indeed, we have our examples, our success stories, and so we have something to be proud of. And by wrapping up the Silicon Valley question, do you think, Sergey, that you could set up a quantum center anywhere abroad? As for Russian quantum center, I don't think I would set up Russian national center abroad, but by answering your question why it was set up exactly in Russia, well, that's a good question. The thing is that the Russian physics school has not extincted, and the best physics are in the quantum physics, and the Russian Quantum Center was set up thing to help of Russian expats, and these are the leading physicists in Russia, in Europe and the United States. And that's on one factor. Another factor is my thanks to Sergei Belousov, who can inspire people, who can attract money. And by attracting finances, we were able to set up the center. It's a very unique case because this case, this center was set up according to the international standards, and that's not heartening for many. And as for salaries and our methods of operations, that was emulated from Western best practices. And as for support in our physicists who were able to be successful in science and in business, we are talking about physics graduates, well, thanks to them, our center was set up. Of course, someone else could do it abroad, but that would be another story. So I understand that Russia is not the worst country. Yes, there are generous people who love our country. I think we need to wrap up, and I would like to ask our panelists to give one very important advice to young high-tech entrepreneur who'd like to launch his business in Russia. Allow me to give such advice. I would ask such guys not to stop learning, because you really will need good technical background. I would advise you to think in long term rather than in short term. I'm not talking about creating a business plan or something, because we are living in a rapidly changing world, and in a month this might become irrelevant. I'm talking about achieving goals and following your values, and believe in what you do, and do not focus on material things first. Thank you, Michael. I say you should believe in yourselves and never shift focus of attention from your product, and the business will take place. It's inevitable. How about those evil investors who says, okay, show out the sales, come when you have sales? These are different things. They just would like to come up with a different check. Okay, I certainly will support my colleagues in terms of vision, in terms of values, about developing education. So by seeing all this change, I should say, do not get back and do not give up. I think you should, first of all, trust yourself, and by introducing the Institute of Federal Development, you should understand that this additional tool, and they should not replace your vision and your promotion of the project. So you need to move towards your project in each and every way. Svetlana, I think there should be two components. First, if you are ready to start, otherwise you will regret about it till the end of your days. And also you need to understand whether you took off or not. So if not, then move on to another project, but otherwise try, otherwise life will not make interesting. Indeed, this is a great advice. First of all, do not procrastinate with the startup, and then be able to move forward. If there are any questions, then go ahead and ask them. Otherwise, thank you. Hello, I'm a startup. So I already had the first round of attractive investments, but we have experienced the following issue. Many investors in Russia would like the projects to be the clones of the Western projects. I'm talking based on my personal experience of a communication with investors. So what do you think about it? And how do federal funds, what do federal funds think about the Western clones and whether you invest in such projects? We feel negative about the clones. First of all, we invest money, but since it is easier for us to risk at an initial stage rather than compared to investors who would like to have a guaranteed payoff, it would be simple. So our expert jury would like to see unique projects. We draw the support 100 unique ideas that have no analogs, and just one and two will skyrocket, while we will support identical projects. I also would like to add that as for earning money, we can do it, but it's boring. So if there is a choice, and there is always a choice, we are not interested in clones. It's just boring. But the general trend is this. But, you know, it's fine. Thank you very much. It's like just opening a gas station or bakery. This is very easy. A very simple, clear business model. It just doesn't work for us. It's not interest of any interest. Okay, thank you very much. We are wrapping up. Thanks.